Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the Lowy Institute, and also welcome to our first AMP China lecture series. And since I joined the Lowy Institute, it's also my first public event. Sorry, please don't be too harsh. Today we're going to, before I start, I want to take this opportunity to acknowledge our very generous benefactor, AMP, who makes the China lecture series possible. So every year we hold 3 events in Melbourne, Sydney and Canberra. So it's a bit of advertising that next month we're going to welcome, or in July, one of China's most famous journalists, Hu Shuli, to come to Australia, and she will speak, I think, in Melbourne. So stay tuned for that event. Today we're very fortunate to have Grant Dooley to be our lecturer on the first topic, and it is a very hot and a sexy topic. It's about One Belt and One Road. If you go to China, either as a journalist or as a politician, you will get a One Belt, One Road question. They will ask you, what do you make of this China's new grand strategy? I think our executive director, Michael Fulila, when he was in Beijing last year, to deliver the Boyer lecture, and he was asked the same question, what do you think of Obo? So it is a bit of a mystery. So today we're having a decipher here to explain a mystery to everyone here. We have a Grant Dooley. He's the executive director of Hastings Infrastructure Fund, in charge of Asia operation. And before he became a fund manager, he was Australia's Consul-General in Guangzhou. And he also served as a senior diplomat in Australian Embassy in Jakarta. So he also had a China Economic Trade Section and a DFAT. And also believe Grant was also an officer in the Royal Australian Navy as well. So and a very interesting background. So he can talk about the foreign policy aspect, and he can also talk to you about risk premiums and returns. I think it would be interesting for our business audience here in Sydney. Grant, first question. One Belt, One Road, or Belt and Road, I think a lot of people object to the term, you know, One Belt, One Road. What exactly is? It has been described as China's grand strategy, or even Marshall Plan, China's equivalent, to reshape the whole region or even the world. Francis Fukuyama described as China's strategy to export its development model. And but, you know, we don't know much about Obo. I mean, it seems to be, especially at operational level, is very patchy and very vague. Do you think, why are they keeping it so vague? Is that a slogan in search of a strategy?
Yeah. Well, first, thanks for coming along today, and I really do appreciate the opportunity to speak and being your first guest lecturer. I'm not sure I'm the sexy man to be talking about such a sexy subject, though, so I'll try my best. The One Belt, One Road initiative, and for those that follow this closely, you would have noticed that from a Chinese perspective, the name has been changed to Belt and Road, and there's a very good reason for that, and that is that when it was initially announced, it was the One Belt, One Road initiative, but very quickly they realised, as you said, it's a strategy in search of some substance, and to actually give it substance, what they did was amalgamate a lot of existing development initiatives that they had at the time, and hence you can't have One Belt, One Road when you have many different development initiatives and many different economic corridors, which is what they brought under the initiative. So when you look at One Belt, One Road, or OBOR, it actually is an amalgamation of other initiatives, one being the new Eurasian land bridge from Urumqi that spreads right across Russia and Kazakhstan, the idea for a rail line all the way to the Netherlands. It also encapsulates the Mongolia-Russia economic corridor, another corridor from Kashgar in western Xinjiang down to Gwadar, the port in southern Pakistan, which is the China-Pakistan corridor, and also one in Southeast Asia, which is from Nanning down through the Indo-Chinese Peninsula called the China-Indochina economic corridor. So what it actually is an amalgamation of a number of existing strategic initiatives that the government was trying to implement. And when they when they thought of a name, the One Belt, One Road, which literally stands for the One Belt being the Silk Road Economic Belt and the 21st Century Silk Maritime Silk Road, hence the Belt and Road name. But it actually is a well thought through initiative. When it was announced, I think possibly didn't have a lot of substance, but now they've been able to build a number of different things around it and amalgamate these economic corridors. The other thing they've been able to tie it very closely to is a number of other initiatives like the Asia Infrastructure Investment Bank, for instance, and the Silk Road Fund. So they've kind of been able to build up some substance to it through these other initiatives that they've got. Yeah.
Thanks for that. So thanks for the explanation. And also, just the question is, you mentioned Asia Infrastructure Investment Bank, which received a lot of media attention about whether Australia should join the Asia EIIB, and there's a lot of discussion about what is China's intention behind to the OBO or behind EIIB. Is a plot to, expand China's geopolitical influence, or if you want basically to make bucks out of it, export China's excess capacity, or more high value added products like high speed railway. So there's a range of discussion. It seems to be a lot of people in Washington DC, maybe in Canberra, are more worried about the geopolitical aspect. Is this China's strategy to counterbalance US's pivot to Asia? Is that a counterbalance to TPP, which China is not part of it? And what do you make of this?
Yeah, I think it's actually a lot of those things, and actually and more. There's no doubt that there is a political overlay, and there's an economic overlay. From the political perspective, when President Obama announced his pivot to Asia back in 2011, this obviously was a cause for great consternation in various policy levels in the Chinese Communist Party and in the government. So, you know, it was actually a natural reaction for them to come up with something which they could perceive to counter that type of a grand plan for what they saw as US containment of China in Asia. So I think at a geostrategic level, yes, there's no doubt that the One Belt, One Road initiative was in response to that. But it'd be too, from a political level, it'd be too, I think, too shallow analysis to say that's the only reason. You need to understand that from a political level, most things head back internally. You know, everything goes back to the centre in China. And when you look at the amalgamation of some of those economic corridors I was talking about, the Kashgar Gwadar one, for instance, that's from Western Xinjiang. The one that goes, the new Eurasian land bridge goes from Urumqi over to through Russia and over to Europe. So in addition to the broader geopolitical issue, there was a need there from the Chinese government to develop these restive regions to generate growth, economic growth in some of these western parts and southern parts of China. The China-Indochina Peninsula Economic Corridor starts in Nanning, the capital of Guangxi province. So it wasn't just about the geopolitical, a lot of it was actually about how do we tie this with trying to generate levels of economic growth in some of these very restive, poor parts of China where, you know, from an NDRC perspective, from a National Development Reform Commission perspective, they've been trying to do that for quite a long period of time. So it fitted very neatly in with that overarching geopolitical plus internal stability narrative. That's the political side. Of course, the economic side, which is what we all probably more associate it with, was to deal with a number of very large issues occurring in the Chinese economy. And that is, as we all know, slowdown in growth internally, excess capacity in key, pretty much infrastructure-related type industries. So iron ore, steel, cement, these type of bulk commodities, these type of skills and overcapacity in these industries that they needed to export. So having an initiative where you build infrastructure in these markets obviously is a way of potentially dealing with those things. You also had, at the same time, you've got the desire to internationalise the RMB. They can also facilitate that. You also have a lot of excess liquidity sitting in the Chinese economy at the moment. We have a lot of debt problems, but we actually also have a lot of excess liquidity in the context that there's a lot of money that wants to leave China at the moment. Good for me, what I do, I'm a fund manager, we manage a lot of Chinese money, but we see it in very little ways in the Chinese money going into the real estate sector, for instance, in Australia and globally. But a lot of that excess liquidity in the Chinese economy is searching for opportunities to be invested offshore to diversify their risk base. So you have a lot of bent up demand for overseas assets within the Chinese economy because of this excess liquidity issue. On top of that, you also, which is I think a potentially another strategic part of it from the economic side, and that is China, I think, will try and use this initiative and build through these corridors to try and secure supply chains. If they can help establish those and grow new trade routes through these markets, it actually helps them with their actually longer term trade issues and growing new markets for their goods as well. So you had a number of various different economic reasons, in addition to the exporting of the excess capacity and high-speed rail and various other capital equipment type issues.
So I know this is a very complex project, it involves multiple motivation. If I'm going to ask you, which one would you rate as the most important overriding objective behind this overall initiative? Do you think it's more centred around China's own economic development needs, say, developing Xinjiang, Yunnan, or this periphery province, who have been lagging behind in overall development in China? Or do you think it's primarily as a blunt weapon, not a blunt weapon, but as the weapon to counter US's pivot to Asia?
Look, I think it would depend who within a Chinese bureaucracy you spoke to. I mean, if you're speaking to someone in the NDRC and they've been trying to develop the Western regions for the last 10 years, and he'll very much see it as being an opportunity to hit some very key, KPIs, for want of a better word, or goals that he has. If you're right at the very top of the Chinese Communist Party, then anything that can grow through soft power means. I mean, this is a very effective tool from a soft power perspective. They can potentially grow relationships, embed themselves with their near neighbours. China's been trying very hard to improve its soft power outreach. It has very good relationships with a lot of those Central Asian countries that go through the Shanghai Cooperation Organisation and other mechanisms. So I think it depends where you sit. If you're talking to a Chinese SOE, really that stuff's all important and it's interesting, but he just wants a good return on investment. So if you're talking to State Grid or China Merchants Group or one of the big SOEs, they're just looking for deal pipeline. How do I get my money deployed? How do I get opportunities to grow my business? They're very much businessmen. So I think it really depends on who you're speaking to within the government as to how they would view the overarching initiative. Yeah.
So it can be many things to different people.
It can be many things to all people.
and just try to pick up on the economic theme. And in the last kind of a year or so, we have seen the kind of a invincibility, the kind of a reputation of China's economic planning and et cetera management has been dented. China's foreign reserve dropped significantly, something like $800 billion. And also big Chinese banks, and they have all the non-performing loans piling up on their books. So do you think that will have an impact on China's ability to finance these very ambitious OIBOL projects? Because I have heard figures that are truly mind-boggling. People are talking about the trillions and the trillions of dollars of investment. Some bankers love the figures. And quoted something like $6 trillion, one-third of the humanities. And do you think Beijing has the means and the resource to finance these projects?
One thing, having worked around the Chinese economy and Chinese government officials for way too long, is that these figures just tend to, after a while, just wash over your head. They do like to talk in grand plans. There's no doubt about it. Look, I think from a funding perspective, which I think is your question, they've already got a number of vehicles that they can use to look at funding some of these projects. And I'll get back to the projects in a minute because that's probably the most important part. They've got the AIIB, the Asian Infrastructure Investment Bank. That's a $100 billion vehicle. We all know about that. There's the new BRICS Development Bank, again, another $100 billion vehicle, which is being seeded by all the BRIC nations. There's a Silk Road Fund, $40 billion vehicle. There's the Shanghai Cooperative Organisation Development Bank, which is about to get off the ground, apparently. And then you've got, obviously, China Development Bank and China Exim Bank as well. So they have a number of different vehicles by which they could potentially fund what they're trying to achieve. You're talking about, to go back a step and talk about foreign exchange reserves. I mean, it's very hard to work out exactly what their foreign exchange reserves are, to be quite frank. But they're probably still somewhere around that $3 trillion mark. And the overlay on that is that China still runs a trade surplus. In April, it was about $45 billion, I think. So while exports are going down, imports are dropping quicker. So they've actually still got good capital inflows. So you know, I don't see that being a major issue, but I think what the major issue won't be about funding per se. It'll be about actual projects they can invest into. So the biggest constraint will be the lack of investable or potentially bankable projects, because you might have the desire. I mean, even in Australia right now, not Australia, but even in Asia more broadly, there's a lot of liquidity looking for infrastructure investment, and a lot of countries looking to attract that investment. But there's a dearth of investable projects. So you might have all the money in the world you want, but if you've got nothing invested into, then it's very hard to actually make the investment. So I don't see it. I don't see the constraint on this execution of this strategy being funding. I see it more being actually identifying types of projects that are actually investable themselves.
All right, that would be that's a very interesting observation. And what does it mean? Let's say if China's intention is more geopolitical, will they just push through the projects irrespective whether they will make a return or not, or whether they are bankable or not in your kind of a professional investment terminology? Do you think that's what Beijing's intentions are? Or do you think these investment entities like China Development Bank or AIIB, what are their risk appetite like? Are they happy to fund the political projects?
Yeah, that's a really good question. I think the biggest issue they're going to have, I mean, Chinese companies will invest to make a return like any other company. I mean, I think there's a bit of a, sure, that sometimes there might be a strategic overlay, but generally speaking, they've got their own benchmarks, internal benchmarks. They want to make a return on any investment. When you get to the development banks and the Exim Bank, it's slightly different objectives for those vehicles. The AIIB, though, here's an interesting thought. The AIIB is being promoted as an investment bank that will only invest in best practice projects. It's funded by various different agencies and governments around the world. They won't want to invest in something that they don't see as generating a decent return to meet the actual over-return benchmarks of that bank. So some of these vehicles will be constrained by the nature of the vehicles. CDB and Exim Bank, I believe, will probably be more constrained by the fact that on their own balance sheets right now, and it's very hard to know this because there's not a lot of detail out there, but given the slowdown in economic growth in China and given some of the bad loans and some of the projects they've invested into in other markets like Africa, it's hard to see they'd have a lot of appetite to go and repeat that process in other markets in Central Asia, for instance, or in Pakistan or places like that. So I think it'd be a pretty big stretch, and it'd have to be a pretty big push to make them do that. The other thing too is I don't think from a soft power perspective, you know, the Chinese could quickly undo a lot of that really good gains they're getting in those markets if they do invest into projects which are not perceived to be very, very good projects, and the projects themselves fail. It'll undermine confidence in AIIB, it'll undermine broader confidence in what the initiative stands for. So, again, I do believe that where the OBOR strategy is really going to struggle is actually identifying those type of projects that meet those near-term investment criteria for them to be able to make those type of investment decisions.
Oh, that's very interesting. If I can draw back to perhaps the lessons here in Australia, in the last perhaps a decade, we have seen so many failed Chinese investment projects in Australian resource sectors. Do you think now they have learned lessons in how to invest abroad, you know, for example, not jump into bed with someone like Clive Palmer? And I think you're probably going to come out on top of that. And do you think they have kind of had a very sharp learning curve? Now they can replicate their experience, say, in Southeast Asia or Central Asia?
I'd like to say yes, but I still think they're learning. Look, you're right. A number of the very marginal resource projects, particularly in the iron ore sector, are still untouched, undeveloped mine sites in various parts of Australia. I think they have learned, but and this is a lesson in the market. You only really learn if you've borrowed money, you've invested into something, and you can't get it up, and 5 years later you've lost your money and the bank comes back and says, well, I need my money back, and you can't pay them, and then you're bankrupt. That's when you learn. Unfortunately, the Chinese system, a lot of these organisations have borrowed money from various different banks back in China. those banks themselves keep rolling over a lot of that debt, hence they've got the debt issues in China. We've got bonds being rolled over. We've got a lot of these various big debt issues being rolled over. So you've got companies that have made bad investments who haven't learnt a lesson from the bad investments. So they actually are still learning that process until risk is properly priced, until these various other things that we do in a normal market are done. It's hard to see how they learn the real lesson of bad investment decisions. Now, they'll understand they've got a bad investment and they will learn, but until that financial impact, you kind of wonder how much that message sinks in. If I take it another step forward, is that they are learning very quickly. Even in my sector, in the infrastructure sector, the state grids of the world are very savvy investors. They've invested in Portugal, invested in Brazil, they've invested in the Philippines, they've invested in Australia already through Gemina and Electronet. They understand how these markets work. They've learnt through the process of investing. What we're seeing, though, with the excess liquidity in the Chinese market and looking at trying to get out, the speed of it at this point in time is so great that you're getting a lot of other people getting caught in a tailwind who don't have that level of experience investing in overseas markets. And they're the ones that are potentially going to make the mistakes that the state grids and the China merchants, now the more sophisticated investors, have already learnt. So you've got this bit of catch-up because of these other more, I suppose, less sophisticated or developed investors who are potentially going to make the same mistakes that the Roller Brothers made a couple of years ago when they did those earlier investments in the resources sector.
Thanks for that. I think at the Lowy Institute, we have to ask very important questions about South China Sea. So it's also for the benefit of our friends who travel from Canberra, and also for the diplomats who are here in Sydney watching very carefully what is unfolding in South China Sea, when we see escalating tension between China and some of the climate states from Southeast Asia. And given Southeast Asia, as a group, is a very important part of China's overall strategy, which cuts through the Southeast Asia, the 21st Century Maritime Silk Road. Given all this tension that is happening, do you think that will have an impact on Beijing's ability to roll out these projects in this country? Or do you think we'll come to a point, some of the country, for example, like a Vietnam or some other country, just basically say no? Given the bad relationship we have at the moment, I don't want your investment, and especially in the critical infrastructure. What do you think? Have we reached that tipping point yet?
Yeah, look, I don't think there's any doubt that it will be an issue. The impact, though, I think can be, in the context of the whole broader One Belt, One Road strategy, could be somewhat more limited, given that the strategy itself encompasses a lot of economic corridors that don't go through those parts of the world. So when I see this, I mean, it's a very significant issue. It's obviously growing in steam, which is obviously all very concerning. So I do see it as more complicating rather than directly impacting that strategy. So when you've got the China-Indo-China Peninsula Economic Corridor, that runs down through Vietnam and parts of those claimant states. So you'd expect that may have... they'd be less willing to be part of that process if they're having, very testy, hostile relations with China. But for the countries that lie further west and the Central Asian countries, it's obviously not as big an issue as it doesn't directly impact them. What it probably can do, though, which is negative issues like the South China Sea and what's happening there, will no doubt, though, raise issues around confidence. I mean, if you're sitting in one of those other countries not directly related and you're reading the media, seeing what's happening, it does raise questions. It does question China's intentions in those markets. So while it wouldn't have a direct impact, it undermines some of those soft power issues we're trying to talk about and some of those soft power gains that they're trying to achieve through the overall strategy. But for that part of the world, being the South China Sea and those claimant countries and the Indonesians of the world. I mean, if you talk to Indonesia, for instance, and I spend a lot of time in Jakarta and still have a lot of friends in Deplu, the Ministry of Foreign Affairs there, 3 years ago, they didn't see the South China Sea issues really impacting them. The Nantuna Sea is quite south. There was a crossover of claims, but it wasn't as big an issue. But as we all know, quite recently, there's a big confrontation between Chinese fishermen and the local Indonesian Coast Guard, which has raised that issue and made it now a substantial issue in relations between India and China. So, the Indonesians have been courting quite actively Chinese investment for their power sector. They do see the Chinese won a tender to build this high-speed rail between Bandung and Jakarta. All these type of things that happen in the South China Sea, all they do is chip away at the confidence that exists between governments, between people, between entities, and just undermines, over the longer term, undermines that level of confidence. And if what is happening in the South China Sea was to continue ramping up in intensity, then you think it would have to have a more direct impact at some point.
Thanks for that. With that question, with that answer, I think I want to take the opportunity to get an audience and to ask Grant questions. This is, I think, a fantastic opportunity to ask someone with a combination of a fund management and a foreign policy expertise. So, any Robert, sitting in the front with the grey jacket. Robert, do you mind to? And also, just a bit of a house rule, and even though we welcome comments, but we like to use this forum as a place where you can ask questions. So I don't want to do a Tony Jones and say that I will take as a comment. So please just ask a direct question and try to keep it short and sharp. Thank you.
This is from a man whose ear I've already talked off on numerous occasions. I do have a simple question, though. You talked about the fact that investable projects would probably be the biggest barrier, and I think that's a sound conclusion. Of the sort of general areas that you outlined as being in the OBR, where do you think those investable projects will be found, or where at least will be more likely than others?
That's a really good question, because my view is those projects will be found in China. And it might sound a bit strange, but we'll talk about this before this started, but now that they've actually undertaken this grand strategy, like everything in China, if you're sitting as a provincial level official sitting in Kashgar or Wurundjeri or in Nanning or whatever part of China, or Kunming, for instance, in Yunnan province, all of a sudden there's this big bucket of money that's been opened up that you can actually reach out to and use to fund another one of those lovely projects that you've always been, you know, adding another 16 platforms to your high-speed train station and things like that. So I see in the immediate term, because of the lack of investable projects in some of these other countries, that the real problem will be perceived, the perception that they're actually not getting on with it. And as such, you'll see some of that short-term money flow into more infrastructure-related projects that actually are inside China. So you'll have high-speed rail up to the border with Vietnam, or and I think we're talking about this, your experience in Kunming, where there's a high-speed railway station up to the border with Burma, and then all of a sudden there's nothing. And so unfortunately in China those things do happen. And I do see, my fear is that some more money will go to projects which don't actually need to have money spent on, and you'll get more of this waste around some of the infrastructure developments. I will add one other thing, though, that is that the rule, you probably heard my theme now, my big issue around OBOR is more about the execution of the strategy around being able to invest the money rather than the strategy itself. And if you look at the OBOR countries that it covers, more than two-thirds of those countries have sovereign debt, which is rated below investment grade. The reason it's below investment grade is because of political stability, economic instability, all these type of issues. So straight away, you're actually looking at investing into countries. People will invest, don't get me wrong, people will invest into those markets, but finding bankable projects is so much more harder.
Sorry, the end at the front. Just wait a minute, thank you.
Thank you. Jeff Miller from the Institute of International Affairs. Some time ago, I heard an Indian comment on the One Belt, One Road, which was, yes, but it's a Chinese belt and a Chinese road. And I wonder, to what extent is cooperation with governments and firms in the countries beyond the Chinese border seen as an important part of this strategy?
Yeah. I was in India quite recently, and I had a discussion on the One Belt, One Road, and that was the Deputy Finance Minister, and he said, in India, we just want to be the braces, which I thought was an interesting way of looking at it. what will underpin this is, the governments can put in place frameworks and various other things, But even from a Hastings perspective, my company, we see an opportunity there to work with Chinese capital to try and find opportunities and how we can invest that money as well. So people at business levels will see the opportunity. They'll try and use it. I mean, the Chinese are very good at following national strategic initiatives. So you can, you know, you'll find a Chinese company will come up to you now, because if they can tie it to it, they can get access to capital from banks by saying it's part of an overarching initiative. And that's quite an attractive thing if you're an Australian company looking at doing something in China, or you're looking at doing something in one of those other OBOR countries. So, yeah, there's a real opportunity for Australian companies. I think OBOR provides two opportunities. We're already seeing OBOR in action in Australia, and that's coming through the Port of Darwin. We had Landbridge acquire that port. The Northern Australia Development Policy needs capital. There's an opportunity for the Chinese who see, obviously, Northern Australia as a great food bowl for, you know, protein, for cattle, through other bulk commodities. So Landbridge's investment very much was based upon the view that that port will become a very integral part of the Maritime Silk Road. The Port of Fremantle, when it's sold, again, I would see that, if Chinese companies there, they could see that as being part of that particular issue as well. So we're already seeing in Australia the One Belt, One Road play out, even in our own market, even though we're not on those economic corridors. The other way that Australian companies can benefit is that by accessing opportunities through the AIIB, through the Silk Road Fund, people like ourselves, like Hastings, and our competitors, Macquarie, how do you invest alongside some of those large institutions? Because if I look at investing into a market like Pakistan or India, we've been looking at India for quite a while now, if I go in alongside the AIIB and I go in alongside the Silk Road Fund, straight away you're de-risking some of those sovereign risk issues, because the Indian government's not going to want to upset the big member countries who are partnership to that, including India. So it does actually provide funding options for Australian companies to look at going into markets and can de-risk some of the investment decisions about investing in those markets. I think that's the real opportunity for Australian businesses. How do you use the One Belt, One Road? How do you use China and some of these initiatives to de-risk your market entry to some of these markets that you wouldn't probably invest into?
Just the little note on the imagination of a Chinese investor. I think there's a plan to build an education city in Melbourne. It's been pitched as a One Belt, One Road project. So everything is possible. So Aaron, I think you've got a question.
Thanks, Grant. Aaron Conley from the Institute. I'm curious, two countries where there has been a backlash against Chinese investment are Myanmar and the Philippines. Mm. And in both cases, that was related to governance issues. In Myanmar, the dam on the Irrawaddy that was being built by China North, a Chinese defense contractor, was seen to have been approved because of a close relationship between the previous military regime and that defense contractor. In the Philippines, ZTE was accused of having bribed the husband of the president, Gloria Macapagal Arroyo, and that led to this big backlash. You mentioned earlier that China is learning from its investment experiences in countries. Is it also learning that, you know, higher standards of governance are also important to the long-term survivability of those investments? Or should we expect more of these kinds of activities to continue in maybe not Australia, where they know that there are high standards of governance, but in other countries, say in Southeast Asia, Central Asia?
Yeah, that's a very good point. I mean, the from my experience of Chinese investors, I think I mentioned before about the sophistication of the investors. If you're dealing with a state grid or one of the 100-odd centrally based state-owned enterprises, it's such a sensitive issue now, corruption. It's such a sensitive issue internally. You know, you don't want to be seen to be anywhere near anything that's going to have a backlash like that. My friends at China Merchants Group talk about this all the time. They've got, if you go to their website, they've got very proud. They've got their own ESG policy. They've got all these, you know, what they call best practice, Western standards, those type of things. You know, they're really focused on it to a great deal. Some of the more less sophisticated provincial-based SOEs and even POEs, you know, private companies. And I'm not a believer in any real private companies in China, but even those POEs at that level, they don't quite have that experience. And I think in the case of the One Belt, One Road, the type of companies that are going to be investing using that strategy, they're going to need to have extremely close links to government. which does raise questions. And to your point, can you invest in Kazakhstan? Can you invest in Kyrgyzstan? Can you invest in Pakistan without that nexus? The reality is you probably can't. And this will go to the whole question around the investability of these projects, because to make the point I was trying to make earlier, if it's only a Chinese company investing into these projects and no one else goes along with them, then very quickly people are going to see it for what it is. And it'll undermine all that great momentum that they've been able to generate behind the AIIB. The AIIB is very critical in this. The AIIB is an institution, it's a multilateral institution. It's China's first foray into such organisations. It has member, you know, of which Australia is, member countries' capital, you know, tied up in it. And they've made a big song and dance, which I think is fantastic, about making sure that this thing works in a way, best practice standard, invest into projects for all the right reasons, financially viable, economically responsible, socially responsible projects. If that gets undermined in any way, shape or form, this could go very, very badly for the Chinese. And my view is that I think they get that. So you'll always have people doing bad things around investments, around, you could even argue in Australia, we've had some bribery issues related as well. So it's not just the Chinese. But I think on this particular, anything associated with this particular initiative, I would have thought the damage could be so bad to the Chinese that I think the NDRC, which will end up being the clearinghouse of all these investments, would be paying a lot of close attention to it. Gives me hope, just that nature of it, yeah.
Any more questions? Professor Dupont, thanks.
Thank you. Alan Dupont, I'm a non-resident fellow at the Lowy Institute. Grant, I'd just like you to give us your thoughts about success or failure of OBOR. Yeah. Optimists say that it could be the most transformational thing we've seen in this century, that if China succeeds in essentially running a 21st century version of the old Silk Road, including this maritime dimension, it's going to not only link China and integrate it into Central Asia, but also with really half the world. So that's the optimistic forecast. That will be transformational. Skeptics will argue that the chances of that happening are virtually nil, and they focus on the risks that you've already touched on, and there are many more, of course. So could you just give us your best judgment about what do you think the likely outcome of OBOR is going to be looking forward 10 or 20 years? Do you think it's going to be some kind of mixture of local successes? It's not going to disintegrate, but it's not going to actually meet the grandiose designs of Xi Jinping and the Chinese leadership, or where do you see it on that spectrum?
Yeah, it's a really good question, because I've actually tried to... I thought it might come up, actually, and I thought, what would I say? No. History's taught me in China that quite often it always ends up being somewhere, generally speaking, in the middle. We very rarely have and that's purely because, unfortunately, the Chinese love grand visions, and grand visions are very, very, very hard to implement. This strategy is even harder, you could argue, to implement, because it's so reliant upon what happens outside its own borders. So for it to be successful, China has to be able to either influence or somehow be able to form relationships with these countries that allow them to actually go through and do these things. That has severe limitations, because at any given point in time over the course of the next decade, the relationships of those countries can be anything from very strong and very positive to very weak and very fractious. We just got to look at the South China Sea to understand that. To use again the Indonesian relationship, which has been quite a good relationship, Yudhoyono and even Jokowi all saw Chinese capital as a way of meeting that short-term infrastructure deficit issue, only to find that it came with strings attached and various other things, and it's caused those issues in that relationship. So I'm have to say that, and it's based on just how I've seen other things like this play out, I'm probably more pessimistic. I think China's really, I'm just basing this only on my read of the situation, but I think that the whole OBOR initiative was very much, while there was a number of different economic corridors being undertaken, there was a lot of things happening in various different parts of China. As I said at the beginning, OBOR is an amalgamation of a lot of those strategies under one umbrella, under one overarching, grand vision, and that is the economic corridors. It's also the Western development strategy of China. It's the need driven by economic policy to deal with a lot of excess capacity in industry. So I think And then what lit that was the pivot to Asia of Obama back in 2011, which we need something. And we've got all these things out there. We bring it under the one rubric. We can actually look at it. And when you make those type of decisions, they're invariably rushed. And to go to your question way back at the beginning, is it a slogan in search of a strategy? Well, I think they've built a strategy as they've gone, the AIB and various other things under that one rubric. They've got a leading group in Beijing headed by Zhang Gali, who's a very, very capable senior official in the Chinese government. But I just think the one thing that's going to undermine this, to go back to my point, and maybe it's because I work in funds management now, but the lack of investable opportunities in the region to make this happen. I mean, the idea of building a railway from Wudumuchi all the way to Rotterdam through Kazakhstan, Russia, it's great in theory. In practice, it's extremely difficult. The idea of building a railway from Kashgar to Gwadar Port in southern Pakistan, you've got to go through Balochistan, northwestern frontiers, tribes in Pakistan. Again, it's a grand vision, but the implementation of these are going to be extremely difficult. So I think in 10, 20 years' time, I think, unfortunately, we may have a lot of development in the western regions of China associated with this because of the ability to source capital to fund new projects in Xinjiang and Xizang and Guangxi and other parts of China. But I don't think you're going to have a lot of outstanding new railways linking various different parts of Asia. I find it hard to see that.
Any more questions? Yeah. Leon?
Thank you. Leon Berkelmans from the Lowy Institute. So you gave a pretty pessimistic take on the prospects for success. How does the Chinese leadership then sell it in 10 or 20 years' time when it looks like a bit of a dud, if that's what it becomes?
Yeah, I've got to be careful here. Pessimistic, it depends what you see as the outcome. To go back to the earlier question, if the outcome is a grand Marshall Plan and I mean, in a perfect world, it'd be great if it did, because a lot of those things would lift economic growth and people out of poverty. And I'm not saying that, you know, some of those things may happen. I mean, there's that many different initiatives that some may get off the ground. Particularly, the greatest opportunity would be, you would have thought, is Southeast Asia, where you do have economies that are actually a lot more developed, but then the South China Sea overlay complicates that. But for the Chinese government, what is there? What are they trying to achieve? I mean, so what is success? You could argue that from a soft power perspective, through the AIB, they've already received or achieved a significant amount of success in trying to play this, you know, role as a global citizen, as someone that's trying to support global growth, taking more responsibility, all things we've been wanting China to do for quite a while. I'm a big supporter of the AIB. I think the initiative itself has the potential to be more transforming than the whole of the OBOR strategy, as long as the actual investments and the way it's dispersed and the way it's deployed stick to what we've been talking about. And, you know, Chris Legg from Treasury, who's been the Australian rep on the AIB, he gives me a lot of confidence. When you speak to him, he says how they've been really trying to do best practice around that particular bank. That one bank itself, a $100 billion bank, I mean, if that can disperse half its capital in the next 5 years into well-funded, well-resourced, bankable-type projects, then you could say that in itself that's a success. So it depends on what type of levels you're trying to talk here. I think the AIB itself, if it's done right, can really lift China's standing globally, because it's a real test for them. If it's done wrong, I think it can actually quite damage the Chinese brand, because they've put so much into it diplomatically, they've put so much into it lobbying very, very aggressively around the world. So that AIB, I think, is quite critical to the overall perception of how successful the One Belt, One Road strategy is going to be.
So a question at the back, yeah.
Hi, Eric Lewis from CITIC CLSA. You mentioned that Obor is now looking south as well towards Australia. How do we make it officially into Obor as one of the countries that's on that new maritime list, perhaps? And how do we tap into that capital that's available? Because it seems like it's a much easier investment to make in Australia than some of these Southeast Asian countries. And also, how do we respond in terms of FERB, which is a big issue for Chinese investors in Australia?
Yeah, you don't apply to be part of the OBOR strategy. You kind of global domination. No, just joking. I think Australia, where it lies, you could even look at a map and say geographically the trade flows and all those things. But the reality is, we're part of Asia. We're an integral part of Asia. We have the ability to generate a lot of economic produce, agricultural produce that can go to meet a lot of China's own internal needs. So there's a lot of complementarities there in the trade flows and the commodities. So it kind of makes sense that we would be part of the Maritime Silk Road from a Chinese perspective. That is what's driving a lot of that interest. I mean, Lambridge saw the Port of Darwin for those reasons. How do you develop a port into being a major transshipment point from Northern Australia into China? That was the thesis of their investment, not having seen a business case, but I would assume that would have been it. So from a Chinese investment perspective and coming to Australia, which is something that, Hastings, the first transaction I did at Hastings when I joined Hastings was the port of Newcastle. And we invested 50-50 with China Merchants Group into that port. When I get asked this question around Chinese investment, what concerns me is the shallowness of the debate in Australia and the fact that Chinese investors have exactly the same, and you'd know CITIC CLSA, I mean, they have the same overriding reasons for making an investment. That's to generate a good return, to meet their benchmarks. They've got exactly the same reasons for making an investment as I do. They may have, in the approval process going back through China, they may have to go back to the NDRC or SAFE, and when they get their final approvals, if it's got a strategic overlay and somehow you can say it's attached to the OBOR, then big tick. But their principal reason for making that investment will be based on fundamentally sound commercial reasons. In Australia, we have this overlay around concern around land being owned and ports being owned and critical infrastructure being owned, strategic overlay and all these various other things. I won't go into that, but from a FIRB perspective, we have a very, very good and very well established regulatory regime around foreign investment. One of the reasons the Chinese like investing here is because we have that regulatory regime. The FIRB itself is very good. You engage FIRB early, it's a very set, you've got the FATA, the Foreign Acquisitions and Takeovers Act, very clearly what you need to do. The problem we have around that investment, though, is there's a political overlay that comes on top of it, which somehow then can muddy the waters and obviously things become more emotional. And then, because in the end, under the FIRB, the final decision is made by the Treasurer. From where I sit, and maybe from where you sit as a person trying to facilitate capital into this market, the only thing I'd argue is that we need to engage the Chinese investors early enough, as the government does. I'm talking here about the FIRB and sell-side advisors like yourself. Well, you need to actually engage early enough to tell them what the likely implications are going to be of 100% ownership of a critical infrastructure asset. I think we need to give them early enough guidance. I think the government just needs to sometimes come out and say, on this particular asset, from day one, Chinese need a partner. They need a partner with Hastings or QIC or AMP or Macquarie or whoever it might be. They need an Australian partner. It's critical infrastructure. There's national interest at stake. Just all the Chinese want to know is where's the goalposts? Are they there or over here? Is that big or is it this big? I just want to know what the goalposts are. I don't want to spend my $3 million on due diligence only to find the goalposts that I thought were over there all of a sudden over here. What do I do? And it's the same as when I go to, if I'm looking at investing in China, I say the same thing to the Chinese government. Where are the goalposts? What are the issues? Investors just want a transparent process where they know what they're getting themselves into when they start that process. As simple as that.
Yes, question in front.
Hello, Peter Green. How does Russia view this One Belt, One Road? And what does it see as the opportunities and challenges?
That's a very good question. I wish I wasn't a Russia expert. I think the Russia and China have, again, one of those relationships that can be at any given time fractious or very close. We've seen that over history. A very big part of China's particularly northern energy reliance now comes through Russia. So there's a very much, as we know, they recently signed a very large deal, I think about three years ago. So a lot of the gas flow from Russia and China is becoming more heavily dependent upon. I think the Russians are quite pragmatic around the relationship with China. They've been doing this for quite a while now. They know where both stand. They have what the Russians wouldn't want is the perception that China, this is my personal view, Kazakhstan, Kyrgyzstan, Tajikistan, and all the Stans are Chinese satellite states and have been. Central Asia was China's background, sorry, Russia's background, or playground, I should say. You don't have to go back to the days of the Great Game, and there's a little finger of Afghanistan that sticks out and touches the Chinese border that was there to separate the British and Russian empires. I mean, that part of Russia. They see it as part of Russia. So anything that puts greater Chinese influence through the Kazakhstan, Kyrgyzstan, Tajikistan, Uzbekistan, whatever, I think Russia would be very, very, very nervous about. They'd see it as very much playing in their own backyard. The overlay on that, though, is anything that stimulates economic growth and anything that actually facilitates the trade and facilitates from a very pragmatic level, they would actually encourage. I think they know that they need more customers. They've got, China's a very big customer. They wouldn't want to endanger that at all. But if they perceive there's any level of political interference or any type of strategic interference going into those particular countries, I think that would make them very, very nervous. So I think, from my own perspective, that they would be quite watching that quite closely, and that would actually make them feel quite unsettled, I would have thought.
So we have one last question. Sorry, just in the middle. Sorry.
Aurea Weigold from the University of Canberra. I want to ask a similar sort of question to the last one about Russia, but in this case about India. Now, when and if the Kashgar-Guadal is a complete link, China virtually encircles India. I think this has some effect on India's own regional pushes in various directions, and India's not always the quickest off the mark. I'm just wondering what you would think about India's view of what China's doing in the same way as you commented on Russia's view.
Yeah, it's no secret that India's been very concerned about the relationship between China and Pakistan going back 20-odd years, if not longer. If you sit in Indian perspective, or if you sit in their seat, say you're sitting in the Chinese seat, how the Chinese view the ring of pearls, as they call it, the containment of India, the US, Australia, Japan, that's one of their ways, strategic geopolitical reasons for doing the One Belt One Road is to try and chip away at that. So they're trying to chip away at this, what they see an encircling of their own interests. I mean, they see India as being part of that. Now, again, no secret that India has been having creating great closer links with the US and with Australia and with its old Commonwealth countries. So that's of concern to the Chinese, without doubt. So there's a couple of things playing out here. So from an Indian perspective, anything at all that leads to a potential strengthening of the relationship between China and Pakistan, which could lead to greater, more militarily than anything else, and Guadal Port is actually a military port. Chinese ships being based just across their border, is obviously serious concern for the Indian government. Again, we're all nothing if not very pragmatic around economic needs, though, and you only have to sit and talk to the Indian government, and their approach to Chinese investment has become quite a lot more positive probably in the last 3 years than what it was previously. And I just know this from my own experience. I've had Chinese investors who we have as clients come with me to meet Indian government officials around investing in India. Extremely positive, rolling out red carpet, we need Chinese investment, again, on our terms. A lot of these discussions you have with the same as Australian government, we've got our own national interests, we've got our own views on our terms, welcome the investment, how can we use it to meet both countries' needs? If you're in India right now, they look to China as a model that they respect and they also wish they could follow to a degree. Given the speed by which people have been lifted out of poverty, of course, you've got a very different political situation there and different architecture. But there is a grudging respect for the Chinese as to what they've done from an economic perspective, and they want to learn, and they can see big pools of capital that can help them in what they're trying to achieve as well. So they see the OBOR in that context. They see it as something that they could potentially work with. They could work with the AIB. They could help unlock some of the infrastructure deficit, use that capital to deal with these issues. But again, a little bit weary of the relationship with Pakistan, the growing relationship. You speak to actually Indian officials. What's worrying them even more is a growing relationship with Cambodia and Myanmar. That is because that is encircling. And that's people forget that quite often, is how much the Chinese have been actively involved in those two relationships in Cambodia and Myanmar. So if you're an Indian official, it's not just about Pakistan, it's also about the other side as well. Yeah. And also, actually, on that note, to make him feel real totally petrified, Colombo Port in Sri Lanka is being developed by China Merchants Group and by a lot of Chinese capital. And potentially the word has been to be used as a staging post for Chinese forces into the Indian Ocean and potentially on their anti-piracy roles over in the Western Indian Ocean. So you really are feeling quite enclosed if you look at it that way.
Hannah is my neighbour, so I have to give her the one opportunity to ask a grander question. So, Hannah.
Hi, I'm Hannah Worth, also from the Lowy Institute. I just had a question about going back to bankable projects, because obviously we've talked about China's initiatives, but the World Bank and the Asian Development Bank, of which China is also part of, are also trying to unlock these bankable projects in the same region. Where do you see the established multilateral development banks fitting into OBOR?
Yeah, the AIIB has been quite open about its desire to work with the ADB. And I think this is really good. ADB is very much a Japanese institution. Anything that brings those two institutions together is obviously good for all of us if they're talking at that level. So the AIIB has been talking about how do they... Because given the political nature of its first investment, they'd have to nearly do it alongside another reputable multilateral like the IFC, the ADB. I mean, the IFC is the investment arm of the World Bank. So the IFC, the ADB are the two logical partners that they would look at investing alongside. The other interesting thing is the AIIB also would like to invest alongside other institutional investors, and they could be... Yeah, we've had discussions with them. I dare say the big Canadian pension funds who are now looking at investing in Asia, PSP, CDPQ, CPPIB. You've got some very large Middle Eastern sovereign wealth funds now, the Qatari Investment Authority, the Kuwait Investment Authority. So you've got a lot of very large institutional investors now who are looking at investing in Asia. Asia, from where I sit at Hastings, is becoming more and more of an interesting market. And people want a club as a way of de-risking political risk and execution risk. You want a club. You want to actually invest alongside others that have a very similar view of the market and a very similar risk tolerance. That's the key issue here. How do you mitigate risk? So I think the AIIB will be looking, when it makes that first investment, to invest alongside one of those large multilaterals, whether it be the ADB, the IFC, or some of those other large institutional investors and sovereign wealth funds.
Thank you so much. I think this is the end of the event. I think we have a very informative session. And do we have another representative from AMP? Oh, yes. Oh, Matthew, sorry.
Of course, they're our competitors. Good afternoon, everyone. On behalf of you all, I'd just like to thank Grant for a most erudite and informative presentation. I'm sure we're all leaving today much better equipped. So thank you, Grant. I think it would be very remiss not to thank Peter for asking such excellent questions.
Thank you, Matthew.
Definitely showing your journalistic background. Terrific. And most of all, to a fabulous audience who was so engaged and really stimulated a great discussion. Could you please join me in thanking Grant?
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Pleasure.